It's estimated that here in the United States, 10% of the total population, or 20 million people, are homosexual. This number is equivalent to the entire population of the state of California, the most heavily populated state in the country. And nowhere is the gay lifestyle as open or free as it is in San Francisco. Of San Francisco's homosexual population is about 100,000. Nobody really knows for sure. But one thing is clear. The overall population of San Francisco has been declining while the homosexual population has been increasing. They are mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, children, uncles, aunts, friends, neighbors, co-workers, and professionals who want to be where they can live freely. We spoke with some gay men at the I-Beam Disco in San Francisco.
My attitude toward being gay is that it's an integral part of my life, and it's a very small part of my life. I think there are more things that are going on in my life besides being homosexual. I don't have a problem with homosexuality. I think heterosexuals have a problem with homosexuality. I'm happy just the way I am.
My whole family knows I'm gay. All my relatives know I'm gay, and they accept it.
Why is that?
Because they knew me before I came out, and I haven't changed. I'm the same person. I'm the same human being. I mean, I have no ugly things scrawled against my face saying I am gay. I am a pervert. I am sick. Because they know I'm not. They know I'm a normal, healthy human being.
I think being gay is a very, really very simple matter. I give it no more thought, I think, than a straight person thinking that he is straight. I feel that what I'm doing is natural. I'm only reminded that what I'm doing is apparently unnatural in the context of this particular society at this particular time in the evolution of the universe.
Upside down, you're turning me, you're giving love instead.
When they're in here, it's like the curtain pulls open and all of a sudden they can begin to really express and to show emotion toward another human being. It's maybe, for some of these kids, the first time they can really show their feelings or release their feelings. So it comes out perhaps a little more pungently to an outside observer. Perhaps we are guilty at most of overreacting, but I think that's fair because, after all, we're overly compensating for what we don't have 99% of of our lives.
Even in San Francisco, there are only a few places where lesbians and gay men can go and feel totally free in the expression of their sexual preference. The Artemis Coffee House is much quieter than the I-Beam and is strictly for women. But they both have one thing in common. It's a place where gays can go and feel free to be who they are.
I was too afraid to say anything or to speak to any of my friends because I thought it would be a very embarrassing matter. That they might think, oh my God, she's one of those queers. You know, when you're a child growing up, teenager, raised in L.A., going to school in L.A., you don't want to, on the streets, let people know that you might be affectionate towards women.
I feel really lucky that I've been able to make it out and throw all that aside and not let the guilt overcome me and just say, no, this is who I am and I've got to be this. Who I am is a woman and all those things that are me, what I like, what I want to be, what I'm trying to become. And I'm a woman that loves women.
Well, why is it a woman as opposed to a man? What can you find in a woman you can't find in a man?
There's differences between men and women, right? And I could ask you the same question. Why do you like women? Are you straight?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I could ask you the same question. What do you like in women? What do you like in women? Probably I like the same thing.
I feel more comfortable with them. I feel more trusting in them.
So do I. guy, yeah.
So it's a similar kind of thing?
I think so. You probably like the softness.
Yes.
I like that too. And the gentleness, I like that. I think a lot of the reasons why men like women, straight men like women, are the same reason why gay women like women.
I've been talking a lot and asking a lot about you being gay.
Yeah, you sure have.
How do you feel about that?
I think you're hung up on it. Or the TV's hung up on it, or somebody's hung up on it. Hey, you know, I'm here to play music.
Are you hung up on it?
I'm more hung up on playing well tonight than I am about being gay, I'll tell you that right now.
Research indicates that most homosexuals are responsible citizens who contribute to society as much as heterosexuals. If you would like more information regarding homosexuality, you can send a self-addressed stamp, return envelope to the Gay 80's, Box A, Hollywood, California, 90027. Tonight on the 6 o'clock news, we'll be meeting two young lesbian women who've been living together for the past 2 years. And
tonight at 6, tomorrow night with us again.
And Friday.
Great. Thank you, Bill. That was real interesting. When we come back, all this week on the 5 and 6 o'clock news, Dr. William Rader will present a special report that's going to be called The Gay 80s. Tonight, we'll take a look at the gay lifestyle in San Francisco and meet two young women.
Thank you, Christine. Here in the United States, homosexuals make up approximately 13% of the male population and 5% of the female population.
Here. That was evident to us when we visited the Castro District Fair, where some 60,000 gay men and women came together to celebrate being gay.
There's a gay spirit singing in our hearts, leading us through these troubled times. It's a gay spirit moving around this land, calling us to a time of open love.
But even some gays are offended by such a public display of homosexuality and sexual fantasy.
Yeah, that's offensive, and I think a lot of gay people are offended by that, because the first comments are always, why do they have to zoom in on the drag queens and the leather drag, you know? Why focus on them?
What are the majority of the gay people like?
What are the majority of the straight people like? Same thing, no difference. They work, they do everything just like everybody else. They're no different.
Here in San Francisco at the Castro Street District, there's actually a higher concentration of gays. And it seems that the gay person here is able to show his or her homosexuality more openly. But what's not really known is that in Los Angeles, there are actually a greater number of gays.
There's a large concentration of gays around most major cities here in Southern California. Not just gay men, but gay women, too, have formed homosexual communities within the heterosexual society. Venice is one of our largest lesbian communities. Sandra Wilson is 24, and Kramer is 22. They've been living together for the past 2 years. When they were growing up, they experienced sexual feelings towards other girls which they were unable to understand. Attempting to deny these feelings, they both became involved in heterosexual relationships.
When I was having relationships with men and I was involved sexually, it wasn't satisfying, it wasn't stimulating. I didn't get aroused sexually. A man's body wasn't as exciting to me as a woman's body. With a woman, I'm more open and more readily to enjoy sex. It comes down to it, basically, that what satisfies me. And what that is a woman and a woman's tenderness, a woman's love.
For me, I kept saying I was going to get used to being a heterosexual relationship. I will get used to it. That's all there is to it. There is no other alternative. I will get used to being in a heterosexual relationship. And that is more of a burden to have to deal with than to have to deal with other people's prejudices.
And you have facial hair. A lot of women have it, but they take it off. Why do you keep it?
It is in this country where if you are a woman, you must be hairless, shapeless, you must be absolutely, you know, you have one image that you can be. And if you're not that image, know, but I like it. It's fine by me. It's who I am.
Being in love really has taught me a lot about myself and who I am, and that I am special, and that I am important, that I am beautiful, and loving me helps me realize that. I'm a very open person, and I couldn't hide my feelings any longer. I told my mother, and she didn't talk to me for a year, but she came around, and now we have a wonderful relationship. It took time. It's very difficult to be a lesbian in this world today. It's emotional love. It's a strong, strong love. It's emotion. It's emotion.
I think about it all day. You know, I think about it all day. I can't wait to get home. I want to do things together.
Yeah.
My favorite person to be with.
Why?
Because we love each other.
Because we love each other.
How do you know that you're not sick? You're just fooling yourself.
Heterosexuality for me is not right for me. For me personally. And that's how I know. Because I've had both sides of the world. And what makes me feel good inside, what makes my heart warm, is loving a woman.
I'm not advocating that you come hop on my bandwagon. I'm asking whoever to give me the space to be who I am in my home, in my neighborhood, in my world, in my life, without saying to me that I am, you know, any lesser than you are.
I love you.
Okay.
When someone becomes open about their homosexuality, often we forget everything we knew and experienced with that person, and all we see is society's stereotype. If you would like more information on homosexuality, you can send a self-addressed stamp return envelope to the Gay 80s, Box A, Hollywood, California, 90027. Tomorrow on the 5 and 6 o'clock news, we'll meet some parents of gays and follow a young gay man as he visits some of the gay bars and discos here in Los Angeles. Terry?
Dr. Rader, thanks for that. When we come back, we'll take you live to All this week on the 5 and 6 o'clock news, Dr. William Rader is presenting a special report called The Gay 80s. And tonight he talks with some parents and friends of gays. Dr. Rader.
Thank you, Paul. Gay men and women come from families of every culture, ethnic group, and economic level. And although they make up 10% of the world population, there still remains a strong prejudice towards the homosexual. But homosexuals are not the only victims of this prejudice. It also affects brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, parents, and even friends.
There's an organization called Parents and Friends of Gays, where significant people in the gay person's life can come together to discuss mutual problems. Cher Boisvert is separated, although she is still very much in love with her husband. It was during their marriage that her husband, Paul, realized he was gay.
We had been having problems in our sex lives. Not that when we shared that wasn't very good. But I was wondering if there was something wrong with me, because I wanted to make love more than Paul did. The problem wasn't me being more of a woman. The problem was that his drive was toward men. I could be the most incredible woman that there ever was, and it would make no difference. I've talked to some women who have the same experience that I have. And I know that they certainly don't love their former husbands. They, if anything, they hate them and despise them. But I don't. I care very much for my former husband.
Do you think your husband is sick?
Sick? Right now, I think he has a cold. But other than that, absolutely not. Any more than I'm sick for preferring men. I know that for Paul, any woman is not going to be as totally satisfying as the relationship he's looking for in the gay community. My husband's sexuality is with men. He loves me as a woman, but his sexuality is not with me. It's with men.
You have a son who's gay.
He said, Mother, Dad, I really have to tell you something. I am a homosexual. I always have been. I think I've been a homosexual since I've been 10 years old. I've had feelings of homosexuality.
The words that I remember are, Mother, Dad, and Dad, I cannot change. If we're to have any relationship, you're going to have to learn to understand me. And it was the reality then that here this young, my son, had gone through a psychiatrist, had tried to change, and that he really couldn't. I feel that he definitely is not sick. I think society has to learn to understand homosexual people. I think that my son being gay is like someone being left-handed or having blue eyes or red hair.
If it weren't for the attitude of society as a general, in general, I couldn't care less.
You have a friend who's a lesbian.
She has made up her mind that this is the life she wants to live.
Is that okay with you?
Sure.
No problem.
None at all. The way she has explained it to me is she is really more comfortable with women than, more comfortable with women than with men. They have a tendency to be more gentle, more loving, more caring.
You have a daughter who's a lesbian.
It was just one of those things that I figured if it was, it didn't make any difference. She's still my daughter. She's still a beautiful person, and I love her very much. And now she has a relationship with another woman, and I just feel I have another daughter. I feel that she was born that way personally. That's the way I feel about it. And it has nothing to do with anything that I did or did not do.
Does your daughter hate men?
No, definitely not.
But yet she's gay.
Right. She just does not have a sexual drive toward men, but she doesn't hate them. I have just one child, and she's a very beautiful person. And the fact that she happens to be gay is one of the incidentals in the situation.
Do you realize that one out of four families has a gay person in it? That means in our extended family, we have aunts and nephews and cousins who are gay, and they may be afraid to even tell us that they're gay. It's terrible. We live in America, this land of freedom and justice, and 10% of our population about lives in closets, afraid to tell where they work, afraid to be discriminated against, just because of ignorance.
Rejection of a gay person by his or her family and friends can be a tragedy for everyone involved. No matter what your feelings are about homosexuality, even if you try to reject it, it's not going to go away. If you would like more information on homosexuality, you can send a self-addressed stamp return envelope to the Gay 80's, Box A, Hollywood, California, 90027. Tonight on the 6 o'clock news, we'll follow a young man as he visits some of the gay bars and discos right here in Los Angeles. Ann?
Okay, Bill, we'll see you back here tomorrow as well. I believe?
Right.
Yes? Good. This week on the 5 and the 6 o'clock news, Dr. William Rader is presenting a special report called The Gay 80s. Tonight he follows a young gay man as he visits some of the gay bars and the discos here in Los Angeles. And we want to warn you, as we commonly do, that what you're about to see will be explicit. Dr. Rader.
Thank you, Christine. Because of society's attitude toward gay men and women, they're often separated and abandoned from their families, friends, and co-workers, forcing them to hide a significant part of themselves from the people around them. Many find their only social outlet to be gay bars and discos. Robert Kimbrough is 25 years old. 3 years ago, he moved from Mississippi to California because he felt he could be freer with his sexuality. Robert feels being gay has taught him to be more tolerant.
If I hadn't been gay, I wouldn't have understood oppression, the oppression of the blacks that I saw. I wouldn't have understood that. I would have probably been racist and sexist right now if I hadn't have been opened up through my sexuality. Sexuality just opened me up as a person. When I started having sex with men, I felt a lot of guilt. I knew it felt good. I knew that physically it was satisfying, but I did feel guilty. I guess just being from a strong fundamentalist Christian background, that guilt was pretty heavily inlaid in me. In the last 3 months, prior to 3 months ago, I spent a lot of time experimenting with sex. I've had a much stronger sex drive. It controlled me a lot more than I do now. I spent a lot of time in bars. At the time I was going, I really didn't know why I was going. I just knew that I felt good in a gay bar around men that I could relate to in certain ways. I never really got into alcohol that much. My father was an alcoholic, and I've always been very much aware of alcoholism. But, I got into drugs a little bit, in the disco and bar scene is, I guess, as a means of escaping. You know, one out of every four gay men and lesbians is an alcoholic. And that's very sad. It's very sad that anybody should be an alcoholic, but it shows that for some reason, society forces us to escape, forces us into those bars. You go in and you're around music and you drink and you talk and you meet people, and then in the sex bars, usually the conversation all relates to sex. I know why I went to bars. I know I went because I could feel more, I felt more comfortable in an escape. I could just really be myself.
Studio!
A lot of people go to the bars to have a good time. You know, I do that. I go there to celebrate. You know, I don't just go to bars out of oppression. I go to celebrate, you know, to party. People who are into sex as an escape, who are into drugs and into alcohol as an escape, that's only temporary. That's only temporary. And usually feel worse the next day or later on, you know.
You know that from experience?
I know that from experience.
It's estimated that 25% of the gay population is alcoholic. One of the main reasons is the limited social alternatives to the gay bars. If you would like more information on homosexuality, you can send a self-addressed stamp return envelope to the Gay 80s, Box A, Hollywood, California, 90027. Tomorrow on the 5 and 6 o'clock news, we'll meet two gay men in their 60s who discuss what it's like to grow old in the gay community. And we'll talk with some gay teenage prostitutes. Jerry?
Well, thanks for that. Population is homosexual. That's 20 million Americans. And all this week on the 5 and 6 o'clock Eyewitness News, Dr. William Rader is presenting a special report called The Gay 80s. And tonight, he takes a look at what it's like to grow older in the gay community. Dr. Rader.
Thank you, Paul. Although over the past few years there's been a greater public awareness of homosexuality, the lifestyle of aging gay men and women still remains relatively unknown. Thirty years ago, the gay movement began. It all started here in Silver Lake. One of the leaders was Harry Hay. Today, Harry is 64 and John Burnside is 68. They've been living together for the past 17 years. I asked them if they had always been homosexual.
We have lived heterosexual lives. Mm-hmm. And so consequently, we've had heterosexual sex. And I tried, I can't speak for John now, I'll speak for myself. I tried awfully hard, I really tried awfully hard to find complete expression of myself in heterosexual sex, and I failed. I couldn't do that. I really couldn't.
We don't mind being looked at oddly. We don't. The sense of not fitting in is something that doesn't bother us. In fact, we get a kind of a bit of fun out of it.
How important now is the sexual part of your relationship?
It goes on being just as important as ever, hasn't it, Harry? Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I would say that perhaps the frequency has dropped down somewhat. But it's very important to us. We can't let too long go before we begin to realize that we need to change.
Without the sexual experience, we would be moving apart and maybe even becoming hostile to one another. But the sexual experience refreshes and renews and brings us into one another's arms.
Is there any negative aspect to being old in the gay community?
In certain environments, we would be quite invisible. Harry and I learned that a long time ago. If we were walking, we'd walk into one of the bars, for instance, we would not be seen.
You mean a gay bar?
Yes, a gay bar. People would just not see us at all. We would not be, we would be a null there. Obviously, that's not the place for me to go. And I would be very silly to imagine that I had anything to offer them, right?
If you go into the ghetto, which is where the bars and the baths are, these people are out looking for a commercial product, namely a sex or a trick. And that is not us, and we have no business going there. In other words, we're putting ourselves in the wrong market. In your late 60s and 70s, you face these things. If all of a sudden something happens to me and I go to the hospital and I'm in serious condition, you can't get in to see me.
That's right. There are many laws that, customs that...
We can't carry insurance in favor of each other. If I carry a policy, for instance, through AAA, I can't name him as my next of kin.
We can't name him as beneficiary.
That's right.
What would happen to you if you were to lose each other?
I've thought about that a number of times. I don't know. I really don't know. This, you see, I waited until I was 51 to find out what my life was all about. I met John. And since that time, it has been the most sumptuous life you can possibly imagine. Oh, it's been rocky and we've been poor, but it's been a marvelous life. And I can't imagine what it'd be like waking up tomorrow and he's not there. I really can't.
The majority of elderly gays seem to have come to terms with their homosexuality. They're not only refusing to hide their lifestyle, but they are no longer willing to tolerate persecution from the heterosexual community. If you would like more information on homosexuality, you can send a self-addressed stamp return envelope to the Gay 80s, Box A, Hollywood, California, 90027. Tonight on the 6 o'clock news, we'll talk with some gay teenage prostitutes. Ann?
Bill, thanks very much.
Here in California, the number of teenage prostitutes increases each year. Many come here from out of town, and a significant number of them are gay male prostitutes. Tonight, as he concludes his special report called The Gay 80s, Dr. William Rader talks with some gay teenage prostitutes in the Hollywood area. We do want to warn you that the discussion will be explicit. Dr. Rader.
Thank you, Jerry. Usually a gay prostitute is a teenager who has either run away from home because of physical abuse or been thrown out by his family after they discover he's gay. Having no work skills or way to support himself, he turns to prostitution.
It's estimated that there are between 1 and 3,000 teenagers involved in prostitution in the Hollywood area of Los Angeles. Many of the gay prostitutes can be found on Santa Monica Boulevard, looking for customers in the cars passing by.
Well, I usually get in the car with older people, you know. They have more money to spend anyway. A young person doesn't really need to be paying for sex, you know. And I'm new in the state, and when you're new in town, you try to do anything you can do to make money quick and easy. I'm not really worried about it, you know, because, you know, I know I'll get out of it real soon, you know.
Yeah. Are you sure you're going to get out of it?
Sure I am. I don't like it. I hate it. I don't like to think about having to do it, you know.
Everybody's either from a broken home, ain't got no food, ain't got no money, can't live, you know. It's a last resort, you know. If I made, you know, $20, $30, I could get a room, and then I could stay off the street for a couple of days. I don't like to do it. It's no fun. To get picked up by an old man, you know, and then go down the road and something, you know, and have sex with him or go to his place or something. It's sick, all right? It was for me, at least, you know. A lot of these kids enjoy it, maybe, but I don't. I never will.
It makes me feel like crap. It makes me feel lousy.
Then why do you do it?
The money's there. I can make in a half an hour's time more, sometimes two, three times as much as somebody that works all day long busting their ass. A lot of the audience probably looks at this and sees, you know, some guy that's off selling his body and being a prostitute and being filthy and nasty, but you're talking about human beings. You're talking about maybe your own son. Maybe you, or if it's sunset, your own daughter. Somebody that's scared, confused when they get here. Maybe somebody that's been trying to get a sexuality that they can't get accepted anywhere else to have the acceptance of being gay here.
One of the teenagers we met agreed to talk with us at length the following day. Daryl Ellis told us he was physically abused as a child and at the age of 14 was kicked out of his home when his parents discovered he was gay.
In the beginning, you know, you first meet this guy, you know, at the age of 14, he tells you he's madly in love with you and everything. And then when he picks you up, he tells you all this and then gives you, after the sexual intercourse, gives you some money and just drops you off in nowhere. At the age of 14 and 15, it's pretty easy because you got your chicken hawks out who like younger people, younger boys, and they get picked up easier. Well, I didn't feel good, but I knew it was either that or die. It was my form of survival.
When you say die, wasn't there another choice? Couldn't you have gotten some help from the governmental help, some governmental agency or a job?
Not at the age of 14, it's kind of hard. As you get older, it gets a little bit harder to hustle, to pull the tricks. Because the guys, well, you know, they always like if they could get something younger, they will take it. It's run like a meat market. What happens to be on sale at the time, it looks the best, is what they'll take.
Do you think there's a worse life than the one you're leading?
Well, I look at it this way. There's You got your bums on Skid Row, and then you've got your hustlers, and then you've got all your murderers and stuff. And to me, they all rank in the same category. Some aren't as bad as the others.
So you rank yourself in the same category as a murderer?
To an extent, yes.
Why?
Because it's like you're out here giving false love. In a way, it's a form of killing.
Sounds very sad.
At times, it is very sad.
Prostitution is not primarily a gay issue. As a matter of fact, there are no gay women prostitutes soliciting other women. Darryl and others like him feel that if there was more of an understanding about homosexuality, he would not have been rejected by his parents and forced to turn to prostitution. Others feel that homosexuals have too much understanding and freedom in our society. Whatever your feelings are, it's clearly an issue that will stay with us as long as society exists. If you would like more information on homosexuality, you can send a self-addressed stamp return envelope to the Gay 80s, Box A, Hollywood, California, 90027. I'd like to thank an incredible producer, Debbie Alpert, and wonderful editing by Sheila Suarez and Lou Torino.
Thanks so much, Dr. Rader.